While messing around with tonight's project, I'm also going to be enjoying Monarchy English Brown Ale from Little Brown Jug Brewing in Winnipeg. They suggest that it has malt flavors of toffee, chocolate, and dark fruit with a medium body and toffee and toast aroma. Mmm. And it doesn't have any weird ingredients in it, just your standard four beer ingredients. Nice to see. So today I am revisiting a project from several years ago. Back in 2019, I built this set of, well, assembled, put together this set of Christmas lights. They are based on WS2811 LEDs, or LEDs with or WS2811 controllers in them. They're essentially NeoPixels or addressable LEDs. These are just the cheap strings that you can get from China, and I strung them together with a control box that I also put together. And inside it, it has some power supplies and a D1 mini to control everything over Wi-Fi, three buck regulators, and just an old laptop power brick in here. Inside this weatherproof box, which, yes, it is essentially an ammo can. You can see that it's been sitting outside for several years because the outside is considerably different color than the non-sun-faded inside. Each individual LED or pixel looks like this when you get them. They come in strings of 50, and you've basically got three wires, a power, ground, and a signal wire, just like any WS2811 or 2812. And these ones being the 2811, that's what the actual chip is inside there, and then it's just a normal LED, normal, that's bigger than 5 millimeter, but I don't think it's 10. No, maybe like a 7 or 8 millimeter RGB LED on top of them. So that's how I put them out in 2019. Just three strings of these, well, two and a half strings of these run across the front of the house, just bare like that. And then for 2020, I printed a whole bunch of these little caps. Just a simple little 3D print, a couple layers thick in translucent PLA, and I attached them on just with heat shrink onto the LEDs, and they held on there pretty darn well. As a matter of fact, they stayed out there from when I put them up in the fall of 2020 until the spring of 2022, when the weather started knocking the string off the front of the house and caused some damage to it. One of the caps fell off, and I have to find out where it came off and put one back on it. It's somewhere in this string. It is, I actually found the cap on the ground. Excuse the noise. Here's the one on the right that I found on the ground, and the one on the left is one that I freshly printed yesterday. So there's a little bit of sun fading in 2+ years out in the weather. And by out in the weather, this is out in the Canadian weather. So we're talking plus 30 Celsius in the summer. We're talking minus 35 to minus 40 Celsius in the winter. Wind, rain, snow, ice, the whole shebang. And that is all the damage that it took in 2 years. I think that's pretty good. So, as I mentioned earlier, this is about 2.5 strings. This is the rest of the third string. And I'm going to solder it back onto the end of this so that I can extend it. I'm going to use some of those printed caps to add onto this so that I can have the full, what is it, 150. And instead of putting them back on the house, because, as I said, the wind knocked them off the house and all these little clips that I had holding it onto the house, they work, but they weren't hanging on all that well, and I did have to go up and put them back on a couple of times. As you can see, they are starting to get damaged after 3-ish years out there. Not that I'm too bothered by that, because all these clips are out of a bucket, a literal bucket, like an ice cream bucket of them, that I bought at a yard sale for $5 many, many years ago. So they don't owe me anything anymore. So, let's get busy. I guess we'll find the end of this and start soldering these on. I'm not sure whether you can see it or not, but the wire in these strings is fairly thin gauge wire. So I'm not just going to rely on that for the power. For the signal, it's fine, but in the overall string, I've added some heavier wire to run the power the longer distance and inserted it about a third and two-thirds into the string. You can see it here running along. This is lamp cord. This is 16 gauge or 18 gauge. I can't remember what I use, but it's essentially lamp cord for like making electric lamps and stuff. So that's going to have less loss over the longer distance. So it runs down, like I said, and inserts at one-third and two-thirds of the way along to help the voltage, you know, not get lost in the resistance of this skinny wire. So that worked pretty well the last couple of years, and adding this extra 20 or some lights onto the end isn't going to significantly harm that. So having soldered these guys down, and having actually remembered to put the heat shrink on before I did it, now I can shrink that inner one down and get it nice and compact. And then after I've done that and they've cooled, I'm going to put a little bit of hot glue on them, let it cool, and then slip the larger heat shrink over the hot glue and then shrink the whole thing down, which will remelt the hot glue and kind of squidge it around a little bit and hopefully make this fairly weather tight. I don't need it to be immersion proof. I don't need it to be completely watertight. It just has to, you know, not let moisture in and corrode and stuff. Exciting heat shrink footage. Woohoo. Put a little bit of hot melt glue on there. It doesn't have to be a huge amount. Just enough that it'll squidge out the ends when this other piece of shrink goes on there. So form that into a tighter bundle again and just let that cool down a little bit. So give me a minute and I'll come back when I do that. All right, so that's cooled down to the point where it's not sticky anymore. So hopefully I can get away with sliding this over and it not shrinking down on me. Uh-oh, it's a little bit, I put a little bit too much in there. But I think I might be able to get away with it, I hope. Okay, close enough. That'll work. It's over both ends, and now I'll just shrink that down. And I've only got my heat gun set for 150 Fahrenheit. No, sorry, 150 Celsius. Much better. And so that should be enough to re-soften that hot melt glue inside there and cause it to just kind of squidge around from the pressure of the shrink tubing coming down on top of it. I hope, anyways. I'm just going to let this sit on there for a little bit longer than I normally would. And hopefully we get a nice seal. I will address another failure mode I had with these. This last connection. So the three strips are connect, or strings, or whatever you want to call them, are connected together with, where is it? This kind of a little plug at the ends. And I found out in the wind and the rain in the spring of the year that that didn't necessarily make a reliable connection. I actually ended up on my ladder a couple of times just wiggling the wires and reconnecting that. So let's see what it looks like. I don't know, it doesn't look as tarnished and corroded as I thought it would. Oh, that pin's pushed back a little bit. That might do something. But regardless, I am going to do exactly the same thing as I did over there with the heat shrink and solder, and just make that more solid so that we don't have that same problem happen again. And I'm going to repeat that on this connection, and there's one other one further down the string. So I'm going to do that a couple more times, make that nice and solid, and then carry on with some other stuff. All right, now that that is done, well, that hot melt's still a little warm, but I am just going to retape these back together. Yeah, to bundle everything together, I just used tape. I agree, it's not ideal, but It does the job. It's cheap. It's available. And it's really not a problem in this instance. So that spacing needs to be about, where does that need to be? Right about there. Okay, so I'll just throw another bit of tape on there. Yeah, it makes a goopy mess. But again, this isn't something that I'm handling on a daily basis. It's hanging up in a damn tree, right? The squirrels and birds can deal with it if they are offended. So, for the connections to the control box here, I used the cheapest outdoor weatherproof connectors I could think of. 4-pin trailer connectors. And you notice I used both polarities there so that I can't get it wrong when I'm reconnecting to the light string. These have been quite reliable. So, this thing should just spark up when I plug it in. The ESP8266, which is a D1 Mini in there, I think I showed you that before, that should remember its last setting from last year. So when I plug this in, yeah, it should flash for a second and then it should start doing things. So now with the room lights turned off, you can see that it is actually working. That's cool. Where is the ones that I added? Well, there they are. So there's the ones that I added. They are working too. Where is the very end of that string? Somewhere in this mess. There is the end of that string, and you can see that it is doing the thing. That is perfect. Right, so now that we know that it works, there's only one other thing that I wanted to do to this, and that is to put caps on these guys, for which I printed a bunch more. I've still got some from the original batch, but I've also got some that I just printed before starting the video. So I'll peel the skirts off those and then heat shrink them onto these. And to do that, I'm going to need, I think I used 1/2-inch heat shrink last time. There we go. What did I use for a length? It looks like I used 20 millimeter chunks. So I will get busy and cut me a bunch of 20 millimeter chunks here. Fortunately, my cutting mat has a nice grid on it to make that easy. But the first one I'll just do quickly here, and then I'll repeat it a whole bunch of times. So that just slips over there. That slips on over the LED. That pulls up so it's about 50-50, and then heat shrink on. And it shrinks right down. It kind of joins up pretty well with the heat shrink that's already on the LEDs, and it softens a little bit into the PLA plastic, not too much. Like I said, I'm only running my heat gun at 150 Celsius and the PLA's extrusion temperature is 200. So it's not going to squash it or anything, but it does get a good grip in there. Weather resistant, again, not completely waterproof, but mechanically holds on there and does the job. As you can tell by all these other ones, out of 100 and just shy of 150 of them, only one fell off in 2 years outside for 12 months of the year in the weather. So I'm just going to repeat this a bunch of times, and I guess I'll come back. I don't know if you want a montage of this. It's pretty boring. Okay, that is the last one. No, it's not. There's one somewhere in here that lost its top, and I gotta go digging through and find it. Hang on. There it is. So it looks like it just slipped out of the heat shrink, so I'm gonna find my knife here. I should be able to just slice that old piece of heat shrink off. put a new one on with a new bulb cover thing. Oh, it did actually break off. Okay, so it broke off at one of the layer lines. And it broke off about that far up. Okay, still one failure over 2 years, 24 months outdoors in the weather. That's pretty good for PLA, I think. I don't know. What do you think? Put it down below in the comments. This should be nice and easy. Just do exactly like I did with all the others. That goes on there, that goes on there, and shrink her down. And that is the last one. So I'm guessing that that guy failed just because the whole string was flopping around in the breeze and getting beaten up. That's my guess anyways. I don't think it would have failed if it had stayed attached properly to the house like they were supposed to. I suppose you never know. Anyway, we'll put the rest of them out in the winter for another few winters and summers. And yeah, those things are just falling apart. Those are horrible. See, the injection molded stuff didn't last as long as the PLA, the prints. I am impressed with that. Is there anything else left to do other than... Oh, yeah, I guess I probably should snip that off and just throw a little bit of heat shrink or tape or something over the ends of that just to protect it. I think what I'll do is just put a little piece of shrink over it and then... hit it with the pliers. Let me show you here. Just put that shrink on there kind of halfway. When it shrinks down, you'll see where the end of the wire is, I think. So it's just right there. And then before it cools, I will just flatten the end. And that will seal it to itself so no water gets in. Just in case I ever want to use that wire, the water can't get in there and corrode. I'll just repeat that for the other two, and then I think I'm done for real, and I can go and put it up on the house. Looks like they're all lighting in their turn. That's awesome. Let's change up the pattern a little bit here. There we go. Something nice and garish. Cool. I'm happy with that. So now it's dark, so tomorrow evening I will go out and put these up in the trees and get you a few shots of them. So one thing that I discovered was that this tree is a lot bigger than I thought. Those lights look pretty sparse on there, but yeah, other than needing more lights and putting them in a little bit tighter pattern on the tree, I think that'll do for now anyway. Gonna have to go back to eBay and get a whole bunch more lights for next year. Questions and comments down below in the comment section as usual. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.